Good morning. Good morning and welcome to the Guilford Community Church's live stream service on this, the first Sunday of Lent. And the beautiful flowers under the cross are given by Carolyn Ames in memory of David Ames, who would have turned 83 on the 26th. And now I just invite you to kind of slow down, take a deep breath, and prepare for worship. Thank you, Alex. That was beautiful. And I understand, I didn't know this until recently, your father plays the guitar. And so I would request those of you watching the service this morning to make a comment, you know, requesting Peter Stewart, to show up Sunday morning playing the guitar.
He's watching.
And now join me in a word of prayer. On this cold but glorious sun-filled morning, we give thanks for our faith, which brings us to this moment, brings us warmth and love and a bigger view of ourselves and the world. As we begin this Lenten journey, may we be honest with the things we struggle with. May we find strength and grace and courage to help us live deeply and meaningfully. May this time of thought and reflection and worship renew our hope and inspire us. May the stories we share refresh our courage. May the songs we sing lift our spirit. The words we speak soften our anger, and may we live more lovingly in our world as Jesus did in his, whose words we repeat every time we say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil, for thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. And now join me in singing a great hymn of faith, My Life Flows On in Endless Song. And our gospel reading on this, the first Sunday of Lent, comes from the Gospel of Luke, chapter 4, the familiar story of the temptation. Jesus, full of the Spirit, returned from the Jordan and was led by the Spirit into the wilderness, where for 40 days he was tempted by the devil. He ate nothing at all during those days, and when they were over, he was famished. The devil said to him, "If you are the Son of God, command this stone to become a loaf of bread." Jesus answered, "It is written, one does not live by bread alone." Then the devil led him up and showed him in an instant all the kingdoms of the world. And the devil said to him, "To you I will give their glory and all this authority, for it has been given over to me, and I can give it to anyone I please. If you then will worship me, it will all be yours." Jesus answered him, "It is written, worship the Lord your God and serve only God." Then the devil took him outside Jerusalem and placed him on the pinnacle of the temple, saying to him, "If you are the Son of God, throw yourself down from here, for it is written, he will command his angels concerning you to protect you, and on their hands they will bear you up so that you will not dash your foot against the stone." And Jesus replied, "It is said, do not put the Lord your God to test." When the devil had finished every test, he departed from him until an opportune time. Here ends the reading.
Good morning, everyone. All you children out there. Today I wanted to talk to you about stress. Do you know what stress is? I'll tell you. It means the weight or pressure of one thing being applied to another. So I brought a rubber band to demonstrate stress. So I'm going to take a rubber band and I'm going to add stress to it. Now what happens when I add stress is it stretches out. Right? But if I add too much stress to this, what do you think is going to happen? If I keep adding more and more pressure, more and more stress, this is going to hurt. I'm going to keep going, and eventually, ow, it snaps. Too much pressure of something, too much stress of something on another can lead to a snapping point. And that goes for us as humans as well. Too much stress in our lives can get us to a snapping point. And we end up, during those points, we end up saying or doing things we normally wouldn't do. You know, today's scripture reading was about Jesus and a story about Jesus. He was experiencing quite a bit of stress. First, he was hungry and eating for days. I know how stressed I get when I don't eat for days. I don't think that's ever happened. But I can only imagine. Second, he was hearing a voice tempting him to do things that he knew he probably shouldn't do, even though they were tempting. So Jesus was feeling kind of like that rubber band. That stress was stretching him out a little bit, and he was getting to that breaking point, that snapping point. But he didn't snap. Instead, Jesus lessened his stress by using the scripture to remind us that God is with us during those stressful times. To use the gifts that God has given us so we don't get to that snapping point. Now, we all, at one time or another, are going to have stress in our lives. And like the story today, we need to use God during those difficult days, those stressful days. Use the gifts that God has given us, these tools, like patience and wisdom, calmness and acceptance, forgiveness and focus. Tools that will lessen our stress so we don't get to that snapping point. And finally, one last tool during those stressful days. Use each other. Use your parents, your family members, your teachers, and of course your church. These are tools that will help us relieve our stress so we don't get to that snapping point. So I hope you all have a stress-free week and enjoy your vacation week. I hope to see you soon.
Thank you, Scott. And as we set aside a time for prayer, I'm happy to report that James Rawlings is home, had successful heart valve surgery, and is doing quite well. And just before the service started, Jane McAllister called. She was on her way to the hospital again, so keep Jane in your thoughts and prayers. And then we want to be mindful of the people in Texas and other areas of the country who have been so devastated and affected by the extreme weather. And I think to pray for people in situations like that invites us to do two things. First, to ask, what can we do? And secondly, and just as important, is what can we learn? So let's take a moment in quiet thought and prayer, and then I'll share a meditation for the day. Let's be in a spirit of prayer. How would it be if just for today, this day, we thought less about contests and rivalries, profits and politics, winners and losers, and just for today, we thought more about helping and giving, mending and blending, reaching out and pitching in? I wonder, how would it be? Amen. Thank you. If Russ Moore were here, he'd bellow out, "Bravo!" I'll simply say thank you.
Thank you.
We need a better story. That was my initial thought when I sat down to read the scripture passages for this, the first Sunday of Lent. We need a better story. Which reminded me of a funny incident comedian Julia Sweeney shared in her TED Talk. She lives on a busy street in LA and is frequently visited by uninvited callers. And usually she just ignores these visitors. But one day, moved by a sense of compassion, charity, she answers the door, and on her doorstep were two young men wearing well-ironed white shirts, ties, name tags, and they were armed with literature. They greeted her with these words, "We have a message from God for you." "For me?" she declares rather whimsically. "Yes," they said, nodding their heads with enthusiasm. Much to her own surprise, Julie invited them inside. They asked her some general questions, and then they shared their story, the Mormon story. She tells it this way. "They told me the story all about a guy named Lehi who lived in Jerusalem in 600 BC. Now, apparently in Jerusalem in 600 BC, everyone was completely evil. Every single person, every man, woman, child, and even fetuses, evil. And God said to Lehi, the one good dude, put your family on a boat and I will lead you out of here. And God did lead them. He led them to America." I said, "America? From Jerusalem to America in 600 BC in a boat?" And they said, "Yes." A bit later, as the story unfolded, they told me about a guy named Mormon. He made sure this whole story was written down in Reformed Egyptian hieroglyphics, chiseled onto gold plates, which he then buried in Palmyra, New York. And then they told me about this guy named Joseph Smith who found those buried gold plates right in his backyard. And then he found a magic stone back there. He put that stone into his hat and buried his face into it, and this allowed him to translate the gold plates from Reformed Egyptian into English. At this point, Julie said, "I wanted to tell these young men, don't start with that story. You need a better story." But after they left, in a moment of incredible self-reflection, she started wondering how someone outside her Catholic tribe might react to some of the things she was supposed to believe. Things she never questioned until that moment of insight. So that was my reaction, at least my initial reaction, when I read the two assigned scripture passages on this first Sunday of Lent. The one I read from Luke 4, the temptation of Jesus in the wilderness by the devil. The other from Genesis, the story of Noah and the ark. Early this week, I read a book called Christianity After Religion, and it chronicles the decline of religion and churches in America, especially among young people, 16 to 30. Over 30% of them identify as having no religion. The church's message no longer feels compelling to them. They no longer feel the need to order their lives around this story. And so I wondered, as fewer and fewer people grow up in the church, how would someone who never went to church hear this story, the stories that we have been hearing since we were young kids, but maybe we never thought deeply about them? Stories about the flood and two of all species in the world boarding a boat along with Noah and his family. What kind of God emerges from a tale like that? A God who thinks the only solution to human wrongdoing is to destroy every living thing except a remnant? And if you're not an insider, what do you think about Jesus doing battle with the devil when almost half of the people in this country don't believe in a literal devil? I certainly don't. I don't believe in the devil, but I believe we all have our demons, things that haunt us and keep us from living full and meaningful lives. The sad thing is, especially a story like the temptation story, once you peel away the mythological elements, it might be an important, compelling story for this particular moment we're going through. And so as I sat with this story all week long, it began to speak and resonate with me. If you put yourself in the place of Jesus, get rid of the winged tempter, but you find yourself in the wilderness, a place of chaos and confusion, a place our country might be in at this moment amidst the pandemic and great inequalities and racial tensions. It is a time of fear and pain, of great uncertainty, but it's also a time of great yearning for something better, something deeper, something more. As you sit with this story and give it more attention than a tweet or a text, it asks important, life-significant questions like, what will sustain us? Will bread or money, anything we buy, does consumption lead to a satisfying life? Will things bring us lasting satisfaction? And the compelling answer to that question is no. We don't live by bread alone. A question like this, what will we worship? In a me-first culture, will I worship at an altar built to myself? Or will something larger than me compel my allegiance? And how will I exercise power? Do I want the praise of people or the satisfaction of doing what is right, regardless of what people might think or say, even if it requires a cost? Ultimately, the things that tempt us are those things that ask us to think about, what kind of person do I want to be? Will I take shortcuts or do the hard work of being authentic and loving? Questions like, what matters most to me? What is my ultimate concern? And maybe the greatest temptation all of us face is simply to be someone you aren't, to be what others think you should be, or to be less than you know you should or could be, to let fear cripple us, to be spectators to our own lives, not letting courage empower us. The great temptation is always to play things too safely when we could risk something new and challenging. The temptation to be quiet when we should speak out. And sadly, especially during the season of Lent, we often reduce temptation to trivial things like eating too much chocolate or skipping a workout. Or like Flip Wilson, we're glib about it. The devil made me do it. And so as we begin another Lenten journey, maybe this is a good question to sit with. What in your life is tempting you? What is drawing you away from what you know gives you life? And is it worth it? And hopefully our goal is to make a life, not simply earn a living. Amen. Beautiful. Thank you so much, Alex and May and Carolyn, for the great music. That song could have only been made better if we had some guitar by the great guitarist Peter Stewart. Let's keep that movement alive. Thank you for watching. Thank you, Stacy and Scott and Joe, and moral support for Cindy. And may this day we experience the peace of God, the peace that passes understanding. Amen.
Take more convincing, man.